coming tonight to social media, the ethics of fake news. I'm Chad Rogers. I'm the current president of the MICAP board. And if you don't know what MICAP is, we're the Michigan Capital Area Chapter of the American Society for Public Administration. And we've been around since 1951. And we've been holding events like this since then that help us to have dialogues around important issues that relate to public service and public administration. So I want to thank our hosts from Western Michigan Cooley Law School. And Donna Duke is going to come up here and give some welcome remarks. And while Donna's on his way, I just want to comment that I think we don't have relationships with organizations, we have relationships with people. And it's only with our relationship with Don that we're able to do this tonight. So please take time to network and mingle and hit our sign-in sheet before you leave. Thanks.
Thank you, Chad. I have very brief remarks because I know we're on a tight schedule today, so I will eschew my usual 40 minutes, 50 minutes. I want to welcome all of you who come here today to listen to this really interesting panel. And I especially want to welcome the members of the chapter of ASPA who are here today. In the spirit of the current hearings on Capitol Hill, I start with full disclosure. I am an unrepentant former public administrator, and I am biased in favor of both ASPA and the Michigan chapter, and I didn't write it down, but I'm opposed to poor ethics in any context. So now that you know that, I have taught ad law here for some 42 years, or at least taught and written about administrative law during that time. And we really share a common background or a common focus with ASPA and public administrators here in the Capitol, but around the country as well. Law schools naturally focus on the law side of public administration, and the organization that is here today focuses more on the policy side. And these two things overlap, but it's important that we keep them separate because we have fairly well-defined parameters for the law side, given our Constitution and the fact that there are innumerable statutes and regulations that are implementing the Constitution, where the public administration side is more dominated by public policy and by the political system, which, as we have seen perhaps in recent years and more so even lately, there aren't as many restrictions on what might happen in the name of public administration in our society. Our country is embroiled in the greatest test of its government's structure and methods since the Civil War. There's probably never been a more interesting time to be a law student. There's probably never been a more interesting time to be someone involved in public administration than right now, and certainly not in the 50 years nearly that I've been involved in either government service or administration of law. While I can't see George Washington doing much texting, can anyone doubt that Ben Franklin would be able to resist tweeting or Facebooking, or that the founders of our country would be engaged in a discussion much like the one you're going to hear this afternoon, looking into the propriety of the way information is presented in the public forum? Does anyone here have doubt that King George and his advisors would have resisted using social media to spread fake news about the colonials? I don't think so. I look forward to what the panel has to say about ethical perspectives today, even if we can't know what our forebears would have thought about it. So congratulations to the organization for putting this panel together, and I look forward to hearing what all of you have to say.
Thanks, Don, for those great remarks. So we're gonna get right to the panel. Our moderator is Megan Holland, and Megan is with the Michigan Veterans Affairs Agency and formerly worked in media. And she's gonna come up and moderate the panel and introduce our panelists.
Well, I love what President LeDuc just said, because especially since he says it's a fascinating time to be in law school and a public administrator, and let me tell you, it's a fascinating time to be a journalist. So, and there are two journalists on our panel who can relate what they're experiencing right now. And you know, I'm realizing, of course, the short person is behind the podium, and nobody behind the screen can see me. So if you all want to move, that's fine. More important that you see them, however. To my immediate right is Emily Lawler, and she's a reporter covering state politics and Capitol News for MLive, which used to be called Booth Newspapers. And they own 8 newspapers in the state, the largest being the Grand Rapids Press. Her work has focused on everything from breaking political news to in-depth stories on legislative transparency and accountability. She also did a really wonderful package recently on the doctor at MSU who is being accused of sexually abusing young girls, mainly gymnasts. She graduated from MSU in, get this, 2011, and lives in Lansing. Full disclosure, I was her editor for many years, and we amazingly remain friends. So, another friend of mine actually is John Lindstrom, right in the middle there. He is publisher of Michigan's Gangwar, and that's a highly respected subscription service for state government news, and none of us in state government and no journalist goes without it. We absolutely depend on the quality and substantive and deep reporting of Gangwar. He also is an MSU grad, and he's worked at the Adrian Telegram, Fenton Independent, and Crane's Detroit Business, so the guy's been around a little bit. And then on the very end is Professor Martha Denning Moore, who I just met this evening. We aren't friends yet, but we're getting there. And she's an auxiliary dean at Western Michigan. All right, I want to make sure I get this right. It's Western Michigan University Cooley Law School, correct? It is a long name. You need to come up with an acronym somehow. So she previously was a partner and shareholder in a Southfield law firm where she concentrated on legal ethics, attorney disciplinary and legal malpractice defense, and criminal defense in juvenile and district courts, in addition to work with other law firms and a stint as an assistant district attorney. Professor Moore has served as staff counsel for the Michigan Attorney Grievance Commission. So she's all about ethics. And she's going to actually kick off our discussion tonight and talk a little bit about the ethics of fake news. So Professor Moore, the microphone is yours. If you want to come up here or stay there, whichever.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for coming. So I want to talk briefly about the truth, how truth matters. And I think Charles Dickens said it best when he said, this is the best of times, this is the worst of times. This is the age of wisdom, it is the age of foolishness. The season of light, the season of darkness, the spring of hope, the winter of despair. We have everything before us, we have nothing before us. These are the best of times in this information age where inquiring minds want to know everything right now. Real-time news as it is happening. Information is readily available and instantly available. So these are the best of times. But these are also the worst of times because information is instantly available, but a lot of it is untrue. We no longer have to wait until the evening news or the newspaper to get information. We get it instantly, as it happens. Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook, and there is no filter. It used to be in the 1800s when I was reading the newspapers that the information was vetted through a third party before it was disseminated. We don't have that anymore, okay? And so as information consumers, we have somewhat become passive, sometimes lazy, accepting of what we hear and see. After all, if it's in print, we can see it, must be true, right? And so this has led to what we call fake news. And even that term fake news is troubling because somehow it dresses up this news and legitimizes it. It's not really news at all. Sometimes it's merely opinion. Sometimes it's intentionally false, made up, fabricated. Let's be frank, lies, misrepresentations, alternative facts. This is not a good path because it leads to distrust as we already see in our country because we're left to wonder what's true and what's untrue. And it also hampers progress because we spend a lot of time just listening to the news this morning, the talk shows. We're spending a lot of time talking about credibility when we really should be spending that time talking about the issues. And so this is really about, truth is about accountability. Fake news means that people are not held accountable for the actual truth of their actions. And this topic is very timely because we ought to hold people accountable for the truth, whatever that is. So then what that means is we can no longer be passive consumers of information. We have to check the facts and we have to disregard the lies so that we hold people accountable for the truth. To a great extent, we have relied on journalists to present us with the truth, to serve as fact finders. However, that's been hindered today because we have information coming directly from the source. There's no opportunity to vet it. There is a journalist code of ethics, seek the truth and report it. And I think that's really important. Even in the legal profession, the truth is essential. In fact, a system of justice depends upon it. A system of justice is all about a search for the truth. Lying is criminalized. It's a crime to lie to a court. It's perjury. It's a crime for a lawyer to submit false evidence to a court. Subornation or perjury. Submitting false testimony to a tribunal could result in serious consequences to a lawyer. People can't file false reports. You cannot make statements that are false against someone. That's called slander. So it has been our tradition not to, you know, to support the truth. In fact, the rules of evidence, I teach civil procedure. All of these rules are designed around a search for the truth. And that's why we have criminalized perjury and the subornation of perjury. Because half-truths, lies, alternative facts, fake news, whatever you want to call it, it corrodes our system of justice. If we look the other way as citizens and as lawyers, then we allow our weightiest disputes to be resolved based on false information. And that is not justice. In the legal profession, if we lie, there's a price to pay. We have rules of ethics that specifically prescribe against lying. Lawyers cannot knowingly permit their clients to lie. Lawyers cannot coach their clients to lie or shade the truth. There are serious consequences. Disbarment, suspension, even incarceration. You might recall a lawyer by the name, a disbarred lawyer by the name of Kwame Kilpatrick. He lied to the court, which led to his downfall. And also public administrators, the truth matters. Because we have to promulgate policy based on truth. We have to administer policy based on truth. We cannot make legitimate policy decisions without the truth. So truth seeking is important. We need to seek it, we need to pursue it, and we have to promote a culture of truth that spills over into every aspect of our lives. Truth is not optional. It is necessary for maintenance of our democracy. Not only will the truth set us free, but it will keep us free. So truth matters. So we must all care about it. We can't just go our merry little way and say, no skin off my back. It is. We must care about it. That means we can no longer afford to be passive consumers of information. We owe it to ourselves and to our country to check the facts. If we live our lives based on lies, and if we make decisions based on lies, there's bound to be trouble. Truth matters. So I'm not talking about partisan truths. In fact, truth is not partisan. It is neither red nor blue. It has no color. Since truth matters, we must seek it, we must pursue it. And after we reach the truth, then we have to hold people accountable for their actions based on the truth. Truth is not based on the majority vote. It's not based on the loudest voices or the meanest voices or the most persuasive voices. Truth is not a merger of options. One journalist said it better. Truth should be something we seek, not something we choose. It's not like walking through a cafeteria line, picking what we want and leaving the rest. Truth matters. And so I want to thank this chapter of the American Society of Public Administration and WMU-Cooley Law School for tackling this timely and important issue. And I know that we're going to get some great insights today from this panel on how we can deal with this fake news. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
I love your passion, and I think that any truth seeker probably has had many moments of anger in the past several months when we've seen on Facebook or Twitter or wherever you get your news. And I also appreciate that you don't like the phrase fake news, because if it's news, it's not fake. News is supposed to be about the truth. However, for this evening's, we are going to just call it that for brevity's sake. And I wanted to throw a question to Emily and John. Professor Moore did a good job of defining what fake news is, but I really also like this definition of non-fake news, i.e. real news. And it is a willingness to retract, correct, or apologize for misstatements in a timely manner, reliance on professional ethics, and a willingness to pursue evidence or viewpoints that are counter to your own hunches. That last part's really interesting to me, because a lot of reporters, of course, we've had our biases as we've approached a story, but you always have to stop yourself and go, hold it, is there another side to this story? How do you react to that, and what would you add to that, Emily?
Yeah, I would say that, I don't know if this is on.
Is it on? Can you hear?
Well, in any case, I can speak loudly. But yeah, I would say that that's all good points. You know, when you talk about that last bit, going against your own gut feeling, you know, sometimes you have to do it. I think the best journalism that's produced starts with an open-ended question and looks for an honest answer. If you're starting with the answer, you're going about it the wrong way, and that's how I try to approach a lot of my reporting.
And we're going to see if we can make sure Emily's microphone is working here. There we go. Great. John, do you have anything to add to that?
There we are. Well, from the standpoint of a practicing journalist, there's an old saying, an old phrase. Probably it first became popular, City News Bureau in Chicago. And it goes quite simply, if your mother says she loves you, check it out. And that's the essence of what we are supposed to do as an industry. But in many respects, that's really more what we should do as citizens of a free republic, as frankly as adults. As we've been, just in a little bit, we've been talking, there's so many things that have come to mind. Dean LeDuc, I can assure you, fake news existed during the revolution. Fake news is not new in any sense. It is a long historical pattern. It's been used deliberately to incite people to do various things. In his book, The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, which is still the best one by in history of the Third Reich, Shirer points out that the Germans, the Nazis took a German prisoner, stuffed him in a Polish uniform, killed him, threw him down, called in a bunch of reporters and said, we've been invaded by Poland, we have to invade them. So that exists. There are just numerous, an unbelievable number of various incidents that drove people in various ways throughout history. What has changed in the aspect of fake news largely is the question of technology, which has driven the ability to spread untrue things far faster than anyone can get hold of them and correct them. The other thing that has changed in many respects is the ability of technology to accentuate hyperpartisanship that puts you now in a frame. Brain science in the last 20 years has made some amazing discoveries, which helps explain a lot of this, a lot of what's going on. And I refer to the great media scholar Paul Simon, who in the song The Boxer said, a man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest. And that is what happens. We have a set point of view, we focus on that. We would all agree that a wise person is a person who will look at contrary facts and possibly change his or her mind based on that evidence. we all know that that is what a wise person should do. None of us believe it. And frankly, it rarely happens, even among the best intended of people. So from the standpoint of a practicing journalist, it is an extraordinary fight that we are in the middle of. And that's really what it is. It is a fight.
And Jen, you cited a great example of how the Nazis used dirty tricks. But Emily, you were telling me about an instance that you read about. Why don't you?
Yeah. One of the most enlightening articles I read right after the election and when this whole fake news kind of took off was in the Washington Post. They profiled some producers of fake news. They had this website. They were very transparent about how it was a profit model for them. But you know, one of the owners of this website, which was driving, they didn't disclose their full income in the article, but it sounded like certainly more than your typical journalism income off of this website. And you know, he manufactured a story about Hillary Clinton protesters invading Donald Trump events and attending and being paid to go protest at Donald Trump events. And you know, he was saying, he was pretty straightforward about it in the article. It was 100% fake. He made a fake ad. He put it on Craigslist. It said, you know, looking for people to pay to that, to say they support Hillary to go interrupt Donald Trump events. And then he manufactured a story based off of his own fake Craigslist ad. And that was something that made it into the national rhetoric. I mean, there were stories about whether Hillary Clinton protesters were being paid to be at Donald Trump events. You know, Donald Trump made some nods to that in speeches that I covered. So I think that was kind of an interesting example of how something had 100% false origins. And this guy wasn't even super malicious about it. He just wanted the page views and he wanted money.
Well, and Professor Moore, maybe you can address that. You know, there are probably a few motivations for spreading fake news. Money is one of them, and that's easy to do in the online world. But in your study of ethics, have you come up with other motivations for spreading fake news?
Yes, people don't want to be accountable for their own actions, because if you're accused of something that's true and you can distract and just make up something else, then you're not accountable for your own actions. Money is one. Some people, we used to joke about this at the Attorney Meetings Commission, but it's not really funny, that some people just have an extra, you know, dishonest chromosome. They're just prone to lie. Greed, not wanting to be accountable for your own actions. And some of it is political. You want to advance your own causes.
You know, there was also an instance in February where a video surfaced on Facebook of a woman cyclist, and she was responding to cat calls from men in a van by chasing after them. And this was a video, and it showed her pulling off a side mirror on the video. And this was reported on by news outlets like the Mirror and the Huffington Post as fact. And others were going, we don't know if this video is real. And nobody could verify its authenticity. And so there was a bit of a mini uproar in the journalism world, because there were reasons to suspect the video, that it was a hoax, and yet not a single publication on record, at least that ran it, has responded to any question about whether they tried to independently verify it. And the upshot was, when legitimate media, and I don't know if you consider Huffington Post legitimate or not, but they're kind of in that realm now, when they don't try to independently verify some of those third-party videos and all sorts of stories, when they don't try to independently verify it, it hurts media's credibility. Do you feel like MLive's credibility has been hurt? And Jen, we'll get to you on Gangwar.
So there's always been good journalism and bad journalism, right? You may read a story that you don't like or something that's not well reported. That doesn't mean necessarily that it's fake, but I think that kind of journalism has always hurt the industry's credibility. Something that exists now that didn't exist 15 or 20 years ago is called aggregation. As a news website, if I at MLive see that, not Huffington Post, but I'll say Huffington Post, has published a story, I think, oh, this is sensational, and it relates to Michigan, this is really interesting. I mean, I could essentially rewrite the story, link to it, maybe call one or two original sources or get more Michigan perspective and put it up there. And I think that kind of creates an echo chamber where if one publication goes with something, every publication is assuming that publication has done their due diligence, and that's not always true, unfortunately. So I think it is important that as journalists we try to verify what we can and also try to you know, independently talk to people who might be connected to an interesting story we see. Or, you know, I think you gotta call everyone you can, even if it's something you're doing quickly and it's a quick hit kind of post. You know, your readers deserve the best information and the truest information that you can find in that moment.
There are a number of different points to the question. Let me just say, first of all, in our publication, if we can't confirm it, we don't print it. And I can assure you that that has driven us absolutely insane at times, because we've gotten tips that sound right, seem to follow logically, and sometimes we've been beat, which kills us when it happens. But we will not, unless we can confirm it, we're not putting it up, and it will drive us insane. There are times, God, I forget when she died. When Martha Griffiths died, I got a tip that she had died. And much as I might on occasion like to kill people off in print, that just didn't seem right. I mean, she was obviously a very important person, and it took me an hour before I was able to finally get hold of a person who could confirm it. Before we could run an update, but it was just, you had to do that. You have to do that, and that is what we drill into. And so we have been fortunate, in many respects, to have been spared some of the stuff that goes on. One of the problems that technology has exacerbated, not just the issue of fake news and how fast it goes, is what it's done to my industry. And the reason why newspapers have suffered so terribly has to do, in fact, with Craigslist, because the foundation of newspaper revenue is classified advertising. And when somebody figured out you could do a classified ad for free, guess what happened to that? We have seen in the last several years total employment of journalists drop by about a third across the country. And the Lansing State Journal, my wife is here, she used to be a reporter and editor at the State Journal, in the 1990s had, what, 50, 60 people in the newsroom? Now it's maybe 20, 25 at most.
And I would suspect state government, you know, Capitol Press Corps have dropped even more.
Oh, when I started back, when we still used quill pens, on average, there were 40 to 45 people a week covering the Capitol. Now it's maybe 15, if that. When the governor held a state of the state, I forget if it was Governor Blanchard or Governor Milliken, but there must have been 40 cameras lined up in front. I mean, back it was when they were all still film as opposed to videotape, and so there were just tripods everywhere and the House chambers. Now, you know, you're lucky if anyone even mentions the state of the state at an evening newscast. So that creates a massive problem in terms of trying to verify stuff, because the other issue that you run into is, as has been pointed out, people want stuff now. Nobody wants to wait. Everyone can pick up their phone and they can see a tweet, or you know, somebody texts something or whatever. And in before technology went amok, to a certain degree, journalists were the gatekeepers. People could call up the newsroom and ask, you know, say, I've heard a rumor that, you know, pick some crazy thing. I heard a rumor that the elementary school is boiling cats and you know, serving those as chicken tacos to the kids, you know. Well, you know, you go check it out. Somebody tells you, you gotta go check it out, you know. if there was absolutely no truth to it, 90% of the time you didn't do anything about it because there was maybe one person, two people that even knew about it. If enough people were concerned about it and raised about it, then you would actually do a story. But in those days, you were pretty much limited to how fast your fingers could dial a phone and how fast a post office could deliver how many thousands of postcards you might want to handwrite with your rumor to spread something. Now, you hit a button, it's gone around the universe 15 times before anyone can even say boo about it.
John, you raise an interesting point. You talk about the cat story. If it's not true, you just didn't write it. Well, Lynn Shear, who's a former CBS News reporter, had an essay today that I got from Miss Cindy over there via email, and she makes the point that, come on, Washington Press Corps, if the president and his administration lies, you shouldn't be printing it. And in fact, you're kind of feeding a frenzy by not only printing it the first time, but once it's debunked, as it appears the wiretapping has been debunked, you come right back at it and just give it a new life. Is it realistic that the Washington Press Corps, that they, it would almost be collusion, I think, if they all got together and said, we aren't gonna print it if it's not true. In such a competitive news world, I just don't even think it's realistic. But what are your opinions?
Well, let me just jump in to say that no. I mean, I read the essay and it's an interesting essay. And the problem with it is absolutely impractical. And that raises yet a third aspect of technology. A.J. Liebling, famous press critic, once said, the press is free to those who own it. Folks, here's your press. You own it. Everyone owns the press now. Everyone can publish. Everyone can send it out. If all the guys in the White House press room, and I've been in the White House press room, it's not that impressive press room, want to not cover something, do you think they give a damn? They can get to whoever they want to by tweeting. I believe the president knows what that is. By putting it on the White House website. By getting sympathetic followers to do the same thing. So you can't ignore it. You can't not print it. You can't not report it.
And I think that there's this new kind of tipping point that social media has brought on where sometimes, you know, the boiled cat thing, if I wouldn't have reported on it, you know, in the 80s or 90s or before Twitter anyway, you know, that's fine, that's where it would have ended. But if it gets to be this rumor boiling up under the surface now, where like they're talking about it at PTA meetings, everyone's tweeting about it, it's on Facebook all of a sudden, you know, you've got kids boycotting cat tacos in the lunchroom. you know, it almost gets to a point where you have to ethically address that with your readers, especially if you're covering a local community, and this has become sort of a community issue. You have to write the story.